Welcome back. In this part of the course, I want to spend some time introducing all of the key components of Docker. We're going to be focusing on what each component is and does, as well as how these components relate or interact with each other. This is one of the most important parts of the course because it will act as a foundation for everything else. So let's jump in and get started. I want to keep this part of the course high level. I'm only introducing things now before you'll learn about them in detail and use them practically later in the course. Now, when you hear the term Docker or Docker engine, think about a client-server application. We start with a Docker host, and it's a Docker host because it's running the Docker daemon. This is the part which does the heavy lifting. It's the brains of the Docker platform. This is the server part of the Docker engine client-server architecture. The Docker daemon is a long-running service and it provides API access to be able to interact with it. The API access is used by Docker clients, which are the client side of the Docker engine. This can either be the Docker command line or Docker desktop, but it can also be applications which you or a developer might code, which interact with the Docker daemon directly. On the Docker host, under the control of the Docker daemon, are two main things, containers and container images. Now, there are other elements such as storage and networking, but I'll be talking about those in much more detail elsewhere in the course. We gain nothing by overcomplicating it at this point in the course. There's another component which I haven't mentioned yet, and that's a registry or a hub, and this is a public or private store for Docker images. Images are used to run containers, so if you want to run an application within a container, you need an image which has that application, as well as any libraries which it uses and any runtime environments, and registries store these images. So in this example, you might have a base Linux image or maybe an image for a game server. In this case, let's assume both are public. Now, to run a container on a Docker host like ours in the middle in this example, we need to have images on the Docker host itself. And we can get images in two different ways. We can download them or we can create them on the Docker host. To download Docker images onto a Docker host, we'd need to run a Docker pull command via the Docker client, and this would communicate with the Docker daemon, which would pull those images down from the registry to the Docker host. Another way you can obtain Docker images is to create them, and this is done using the Docker build command, also via the client. This command takes as an input something known as a Docker file. Now, a Docker file is a list of directives or statements on how to create a Docker image. And don't worry, I'll be covering this later in the course. You're even going to create your own. The client gives that Docker file to the Docker daemon, and the Docker daemon uses this Docker file to create an image. Once you have one or more images running on the Docker host, you can use the Docker run command, and the Docker daemon will use this command and run containers using Docker images. A container is just like a Docker image, only instead of being read-only, we add a read-write component, and this becomes a container. It allows data to be stored within that container and allows the container to be run on a Docker host. Once containers are running, they can be stopped and started during their lifecycle. You can also, once you've created images, push these into a registry, for example, Docker Hub. And again, these can be public or private. And you do this using the Docker push command. Docker push takes an image that's on the Docker host and pushes it into a registry. Now, at a high level, this is the architecture of a typical Docker deployment. You might have one host or 100, one image or 1,000, one container or many containers. The architecture, at a high level, is the same. Now, there are many other components that I've yet to talk about, and I've kept this to a high level, so there are certain things that I've said that do have some technical nuance. But this is the foundation that we'll build on and expand as we move through this part of the course. At this point, though, that's everything that I wanted to talk about right now. I hope it was understandable. If not, just go ahead and watch this part of the course again. Otherwise, when you're ready, go ahead and move on to the next part of the course.